Allah Samad. Allah, the absolute eternal. Was Rajneesh absolute eternal? We know from his biography, from his autobiography, he was suffering from asthma, from diabetes, from chronic backache. Imagine Almighty God suffering from asthma, diabetes, chronic backache. Third test, Lam Yulad Valam Yulad. He begets not, nor is begotten. Bhagavan Rajneesh was born in Madhya Pradesh. He had a father and mother. In 1981, he goes to America, USA, and he takes thousands of Americans for a ride. In the state of Oregon, he starts his center and calls it as Rajneeshpuram, his village. Later on, the American government arrests him and put him behind bar. Rajneesh says, the American government slow poisoned me. Imagine Almighty God being slow poisoned. In 1985, the American government kick him out of the country. He comes back to India in the same city, Pune, and he goes back to his center, which is now called as Osho Commune. And if you go to the Samadhi of Rajneesh, it is mentioned there on the Samadhi, Bhagavan Rajneesh, Osho, never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. Never born, never died, but visited the earth from the 11th of December 1931 to the 19th of January 1990. They forgot to mention in Samadhi, he was not given visas to 21 countries of the world. Almighty God coming in this world to visit the world and requires visas to go to different countries. And the Archbishop of Greece said, if you don't remove Rajneesh out of this country, we'll burn his house and the house of his disciples. And the last test, Valam Yakulla Kufanath, is so stringent that no one besides the true Almighty God can pass. The moment you can compare God to anything, he's not God. Valam Yakulla Kufanath. We know Rajneesh, like the human beings, had a beard, one nose, two eyes, two ears, two hands. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he's not God. Valam Yakulla Kufanath. If someone says Almighty God is 1,000 times stronger than Arnold Schwarzenegger. You might have heard the name of Arnold Schwarzenegger. Have you heard Arnold Schwarzenegger? The person who got the title Mr. World, Mr. Universe. The strongest man in the world, the strongest man in the universe. The moment you can compare God to anyone, whether it be Arnold Schwarzenegger, whether it be Dara Singh, whether it be King Kong, whether it be 1,000 times or 1,000,000 times. The moment you can compare God to anything in this world, he is not God. Valam yakullahu kuffanat. There is nothing like him. So this is a four-line definition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given in the Quran. Whichever God you are worshipping, brother, put that God to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If that God passes, that is the true God. Otherwise, it's a fake God.
Respected Naik Sahab, my name is V. Balasubramaniam. I would like to ask a question. What is the definition of sin in Islam? What are the various kinds of sins? How is this definition different from that given in Hinduism, Christianity, and other religions? Thank you.
The brother asked the question that what is the definition of sin in Islam and how does it differ from the definition in Hinduism and Christianity? In short, sin means disobeying the commandment of Almighty God. If whatever Almighty God says, and if you go against it, it's a sin. For example, Almighty God says that you should pray. If you don't pray, you're doing a sin. If Almighty God says, don't have alcohol, and if you have alcohol, you're doing a sin. So disobeying the commandment of Almighty God, in short, is a sin. And this sin has a similar definition in all the religions, including Hinduism and Christianity. Hope that answers the question.
Question from the center mic, please.
Dr. Sakir Naik, I am Jerry Thomas. I am a research scholar in journalism at the Usmania University, and we and our friends run a site called SakshiTimes.com. I have questions to you. One, I always knew that Quran is incomplete without Hadith. Now you are referring to other scriptures also. Since you have referred to Bible, Bible says anybody who denies Jesus Christ is the spirit of Antichrist. That is a prophecy. And I also know that Hadith says that Muhammad had diabolical inspiration. What should I conclude from this?
The brother asked a question in which I have mentioned a few sentences. He said that he knows that the Quran is incomplete without the Hadith, and now he has heard other scriptures also. That means if I quote the Bible, that means you have to follow the Bible. And he says, the Bible says, anyone who does not believe and deny Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is diabolic, etc., will go to hell, etc., etc. So what are my comments? Point number one. The Quran is not incomplete without the Hadith. The Quran is complete by itself. But to understand the Quran, you have to go to the commentary of the Quran. The commentary of the Quran is the Hadith, that is the authentic saying of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Quran by itself is a complete book, alhamdulillah, by itself. But if you want commentary in more details about it, then you refer to the sayings, the authentic sayings of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which we call as Sahih Hadith. Now, just because I quoted the other scriptures, that does not mean I agree that all the other scriptures are the word of God. Please don't misunderstand me. I was using the strategy of the Quran. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse number 64, Ta'ala ila kalmitin sawa imbayana bainakum. Come to common terms as between us and you. We are coming to common terms. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Ra'd chapter number 13 verse number 38, Wali kulli qaumin had, and in every age have we sent a revelation. Allah sent several revelations, several books. By name, only four are mentioned in the Quran. The Torah, the Zabur, the Injil and the Quran. The Torah is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Moses, peace be upon him. The Zabur is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to David, peace be upon him. The Injil is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And Quran is the last and final revelation which was given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, since all the previous revelations came only for a particular group of people and they were meant to be followed in totality for a particular time period, Almighty God did not think it fit to preserve it in pristine purity. But because Quran was the last and final revelation, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 9, we have revealed the Quran and we shall guard it from corruption. So Quran is the only religious book on the face of the earth which is in its pure form. I'm not saying that. Even the scholars of comparative religion, including William Moore, who's one of the staunchest critics of Islam, being a Christian, he said 200 years earlier that there is no religious book which has maintained its pure form for more than 1200 years. Now it is more than 1400 years, like the Quran. Being a Christian, being a staunchest critic of Islam, he has to be truthful that Quran is its pure form. Now all the other religious scriptures have changed its form, including the Bible. I don't consider the Bible to be the word of God. We Muslims believe in the Wahi which was given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, the Injil. But the present Bible that we have, brother, this Bible, it's a mixture. It may contain words of God which match with the Quran. I have got no problem in accepting it to the word of God. It also contains the words of the prophets. It contains the word of historians. I'm sorry to say, it even contains pornography. I can't quote it here. I can't. It even contains hundreds of contradictions, scientific errors, mathematical errors, which I can't repeat here. But I had a dialogue with Dr. William Campbell. He wrote a book against Islam, the Quran and the Bible in the light of history and science. And he said, the Quran has got 30 scientific errors. I went to USA, he's from Philadelphia, and we had a debate in the year 2000, 1st April, on the topic, the Quran and the Bible in the light of science. And I answered to all his allegations. And when I pointed out 38 contradictions in the Bible, he could not reply to them. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah chapter number 2 verse number 79, Allah says, فَوَيْلٌ لِلَّذِينَ يَكْتُبُونَ الْكِتَابَ بِأَيْدِهِمْ ثُمَّ يَقُلُونَ هَذَا مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ لِيَشْتَرُوا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا كَتَبَتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ فَوَيْلٌ لَهُمْ مِمَّا يَكْسِبُونَ. Woe to those who write the book with their own hands and then say this is from Allah, to traffic with it for a miserable price. Woe to those for what they write, woe to those for what they earn. So today's Bible, if you know, the word Bible is not there in the Bible. It comes from the Greek word Biblos, meaning a book of books. And the scholars say there are many authors of the Bible, not I, the Christian scholars. So the present Bible I don't consider to be the word of God. Similarly, if you ask me, can you consider Veda to be the word of God? Can you consider the Buddhist scripture to be the word of God? Can you consider the Parsi script word of God? What I say. Maybe they were, maybe they were not. Since there were many scriptures sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, many books, by name four are mentioned. But there were many other like Sufi, Ibrahim, several others. So what I say, maybe Hindu scriptures may be word of God. Maybe Buddhist scriptures may be word of God. Maybe Parsi scriptures were the word of God. But even if they were meant for those people and for that time. Today, you have to follow the last and final revelation. That is the glorious Quran. So any human being, whether living in India, in America, in Canada, in UK, in Singapore, in Saudi Arabia, all the human beings in the world should follow the last and final revelation, the glorious Quran, and the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.